end of the Civil War was near when quite accidentally a hero who sneezed abruptly seized retreat and reversed it to victory. His Medal of Honor pleased and thrilled his proud little family group. While pinning it on, some blood was spilled, and so it was planned he'd command F Troop, where Indian fights are colorful sights and nobody takes a lickin', where pale face and red skin both turn chicken. When drilling and fighting get them down, they know their morale can't droop, as long as they all relax in town before they resume with a bang and a boom. F Troop!
Wants us to give him our cannon?
It's good we only do this twice a day.
Hey, Garden.
Stop!
Shh. Never sneak up on me like that again, Sarge. You almost scared me to death.
What are you doing?
Captain Palmer, and I got an important letter from Army headquarters, and I'm trying to find out what's in it.
Oh, Corporal Agarn, I'm glad you dropped in.
Sorry about that, Captain. My horse stopped short.
Yeah, them Indians sure know how to make whiskey. I'd hate to get hit by an arrow dipped in that stuff.
I think that's the best batch the Hekawi ever sent. The last shipment had just a taste of moccasin.
Happy New Year!
Corporal Agarn will go down in history as the man who slew Geronimo.
What's up?
The famous Mexican bandit El Diablo was reported seen in the territory.
Yeah, here's his picture.
Oh, no!
What's the matter, Corporal?
Do you know what El Diablo's real name is? Agarnado.
Agarnado?
So what?
El Diablo is my cousin!
Wouldn't your relatives be upset with you if you turned in your own flesh and blood?
None of my family ever liked him, sir. Take Granny Agarn in Passaic. If you could ask Granny Agarn in Passaic what she thought about cousin, she'd say,
I always said Pancho Agarnado would never amount to a hill of beans, which he kept eating all over my living room rug.
Then you could ask my Uncle Gaylord Agarn in Tallahassee.
I tell you, sir, my nephew Pancho Agarnado is the boll weevil in the Agarn family cotton bush.
You could even ask his own sister about him, my cousin Carmen.
Pancho! Es un desgraciado! Un borracho cucaracho! Que si la ceja de majo no saben ni velar sin vergüenza que encuerdo cebolete en la cabeza en cabote! ¡No puedo creer!
Stop! Blow assembly!
All right, Agarn, get him in some kind of a line.
All right, air troop!
You are the men of F Troop, defenders of the West. The eyes of Washington are on all of us.
All of us. Gravy stains, Donaldson, gravy stains!
Ah!
anybody understand what she's saying?
I understand a little Apache, Captain. Me, Corporal Agarn. Bunda Lomas.
Well, she seemed to understand that.
Why don't you open it and see who it's from, huh?
Hey, it's an absentee ballot. I'm supposed to vote.
Well, I don't suppose you men would like some of my mother's cookies.
Oh, not just right now.
Thank you, sir.
Which one of these guys are you going to vote for? This Dan McGurney or George Bragan?
Me? Vote? What good would my little vote do?
Anyway, you added up, Mindy, it still comes out a tie.
I don't get it, Uncle Dan. It's one chance in a million that an election can turn out a tie.
Everybody who knows what Bragan stands for must have voted for me. And everybody who knows what I stand for must have voted for Bragan. And we both know the same number of people.
Now what happens? Are you going to demand a recount and fix it?
Not just yet.
There happens to be one absentee ballot that hasn't come in yet.
The deciding vote. I just know he'll be in your corner, Uncle Dan. I just know it.
I'm not so sure. He's been away in the army, stationed in some place called Fort Courage.
Well, whose ballot is it?
It's the ballot of Corporal Randolph Agarn.
I'd just love to get better acquainted with one of our fighting men from Passaic.
But he did more fighting in Passaic than he's done since he's been out here.
All right, you men, don't just stand there, hit that Indian!
And I said to Uncle Dan, Uncle Dan, I just know that a handsome, intelligent young man like Randolph Agarn will vote for you.
You knew I was handsome and intelligent, and you hadn't even met me.
Then I can count on you, my boy.
I only regret that I have but one vote to give to my city.
Sarge, you know anybody who wants to buy a vote?
Start again.
Look, oh brothers! Look who's here for you! Why don't you big, strong Indians come over here and give a shy Indian maiden some loving and some kissing? Watch this!
What's he doing?
That's the Indian love dance. He learned it from the Hekawis last New Year's Eve. George Washington. First in war, first in peace.
Me?
First in the hearts of his F troop buddies. General Washington, sir, we salute you.
It'll never work, I tell you. A flaming arrow may be feeble, but he's not feeble-minded.
Hold on, hold still.
If he falls for this, I'm Napoleon.
You're not Napoleon, you're George Washington.
I know. I can tell by my curls.
Yeah. Agarn, please be quiet. I can't get this hat to fit.
Yeah, well, he can't help it if it's a three-cornered hat and he's got a four-cornered head.
Please do this, Corporal Agarn. You're the only chance we have at ever getting a square meal again.
Well, if you put it that way, sir.
All right. Now, remember what all you know about Washington.
It's 100 miles from Passaic.
George Washington. And remember, you were born in 1732.
When did I die?
You didn't die.
I didn't, eh? Well, that makes me feel better.
Now, remember, you once threw a dollar across the Potomac.
I'm very reckless with my money.
Now, what was your wife's name?
Mrs. Washington.
Her first name?
Mrs. George Washington. How do I know?
No. Your wife's name was Martha Custis, and she was a wealthy widow.
Wealthy, huh? No wonder I'm reckless with my money.
Now, remember, at the end of the war, you said goodbye to your faithful officers at Francis Tavern.
Farewell, my brave soldiers! But before I go, could I have a nice thick steak smothered with onions?
Agarn.
How about spaghetti with metal tips?
Out.
Everything depends on you, Corporal. Oh, but I'm sure this will work. Why, you're the very image of George Washington.
Mm. Captain Parmenter, isn't that... No, it couldn't be.
Go ahead, Dobbs. Isn't that who?
Thomas Jefferson, sir.
Oh, if I could have got you at Valley Forge.
Who there?
George!
George who? George! Washington!
Yes, my old comrade in arms. Why are you so surprised to see me?
First me think you Thomas Jefferson.
Flaming Arrow! I've come to talk to you.
You not dead?
Oh, of course not. I just retired from public service. You know how it is with us old soldiers. We never die. We just write our memoirs.
If you're not dead, who they bury at Mount Vernon?
King George III. It was the only way he could keep his own piece of American soil.
Be glad to see you, George. How old bunch?
Gone. All gone. Very sad. Tom, Ben, the Adams boys, all gone.
How Betsy?
Betsy.
Oh, that Betty. Betty Ross. Look. Fingers stiffen up a little bit, but she still manages to sew on a new star every once in a while.
Why are you so hungry?
I'm breaking in a new set of false teeth. Why don't we go outside where we can talk better?
No, we talk more better here.
It's too warm here. Ever since Valley Forge, I'm used to the cold.
You forgot muffler again?
Please, if I want to be nagged, I can always go home to Martha. Flaming Arrow, what's this I hear about you making war again?
Just want Hekawi land back.
But the pale faces have always been your friends. Remember Nathan Hale. Remember Paul Revere. Remember Patrick Henry.
They not make pale faces like that anymore.
Come back to my place, and we'll talk over old times, Flaming Arrow.
No, maybe me better go back to camp.
No, don't do that. I've got a surprise for you.
Listen, George, they're playing our song.